Hello everybody, my name is Zohir Chaudhry and right now we'll talk about the hydrologic cycle. So what is the hydrologic cycle or the water cycle? Water is in continuous motion. The natural cycle by which water evaporates from oceans and other water bodies, accumulates as water vapor in clouds, and returns to oceans and other water bodies as precipitation is known as the hydrologic cycle. Without continuous evaporation from the oceans, precipitation on land, and runoff back to the oceans, no surface or groundwater recharge can take place, and we would eventually exhaust our available freshwater supplies. This figure provides an overview of the hydrologic cycle and dominant flows and the critical reservoirs. The hydrologic cycle teaches us to view water and health with a holistic perspective. The compartments of the hydrologic cycle are either directly or indirectly connected, and perturbation in one compartment is likely to affect all other compartments and therefore both human and ecological health. So this water cycle, we humans have centered it around us, and so we know that available freshwater supplies are often conceptually divided into surface water and groundwater. Surface water includes all water naturally open to the atmosphere, like such as rivers, lakes, reservoirs, ponds and streams, impoundments, seas and estuaries. Groundwater is a supply of fresh water found beneath the Earth's surface, usually in aquifers, groundwater supplies, wells, as well as springs. Ideally, water used as drinking water source should be of the highest quality, reducing the cost of water treatment and the risk of contamination. Groundwater has traditionally been considered a high-quality resource because as rainfall and other surface water percolates through soil into groundwater, they're cleaned by physical, chemical, and microbial processes in the soil. However, groundwater is not always available, and municipalities may have no choice but to use surface water, requiring extensive and costly water treatment. Surface water may be considered suitable for agriculture, industrial, or recreational uses with no or limited treatment. Different criteria are therefore developed and applied to source waters depending on their ultimate use. Surface water that are used as drinking water sources are regulated by far stricter criteria, for example, than waters used to irrigate crops. In this chart, we can see the water cycle as it makes its way through the river into the ocean. Humans have created dams, and as a result of the dam, the water is stored. And this has permitted humans to use water year-round to supply water to municipalities, such as the one shown in here. And in this case, because this is surface water, water has to be treated, pumped into homes and businesses, and once it is utilized, humans produce sewage, and in this case the sewage gets collected, treated again, and then pumped into water reservoirs, rivers, or oceans, thus completing the water cycle with the human component incorporated in it. Global water availability. This map shows that the global water availability pointing out areas where water is overexploited. The overexploited regions are in maroon, heavily exploited regions in red, and moderately exploited regions in orange. Of course, the arid regions face the most severe problems. In fact, 85% of the world population lives in the driest half of the planet. Water availability is expected to decrease in many regions due to climate change, population growth, and increased demand for water from agriculture. It has been shown that future global agriculture water consumption alone is estimated to increase by about 19% by 2050 and be even greater in the absence of any technological progress or policy intervention. This graph in here shows the residential usage around the globe in the state of California and in the county of San Diego. So as you can see around the globe, agriculture is the major consumer of water, whereas for the state of California, it's more or less evenly distributed almost about 30 to 40% between agriculture, industry, and residential. But as we move to Southern California, this is a very drier place of California, and San Diego County is an example, 60% is used in residential homes, and only 17% for agriculture and 23% by industry. So San Diego County, as compared to the globe, definitely has a very different approach in residential water usage. And here is how this residential water usage is divided. A big chunk of the water in San Diego County is used for landscaping, and then the remaining is used for other purposes for home. In California, the water cycle, of course, provides more water in the northern part of the state because of increased precipitation and snowmelt. On the other hand, in the southern part of the state, there's not enough precipitation, making it very dry. And from an engineering perspective, of course, you think about that if people are living a lot in the drier part, you'd have to bring water from the northern part to the southern part. In fact, the map in here shows that a lot of the population lives in the southern half of the state, especially in Los Angeles, San Diego County, and significant people also live in San Francisco and Sacramento counties, with a little bit in the Central Valley area. So most of the water is in the northern part, where population is relatively sparse, whereas in the southern part, water is not as widely available, but population is pretty dense. Okay, so let's do some quick check. The natural cycle by which water evaporates from oceans and other water bodies accumulates as water vapor in clouds and returns to oceans as water bodies as precipitation is known as B, hydrologic cycle. Another concept check. Water availability is expected to decrease in many regions of the world due to climate change, population growth, and increased water demand for agriculture. True or false? True. Okay.